These things, Jesus is speaking, by the way, these things have I spoken unto you that you should not be offended. They shall put you out of the synagogues. They don't want to hear what you have to say. How about that one? Yep, first and foremost, they don't want to hear what you have to say. Who are the they? We're going to look at this soberly. If somebody puts you out of the synagogue, then who are the people of the synagogue? Those who run the synagogues. Those who count themselves as leaders in the synagogues. Not the people sitting and listening, but the people who are running things in the synagogue. They don't want to hear anything you have to say. They're going to throw you out of the synagogue, which means your Lord's going to give you an agenda that's different than theirs. Theirs is going to be of a traditional type of speech. What the Lord gives you is going to be somewhat fresh and different to their hearing. So they will toss you out. They don't want to hear what you have to say. So he's telling us these things before they ever happen so that we are not offended. They're not going to want to hear what you have to say. And sure enough, you guys know how it is among your family members and your friends or those that understood the Bible before you. They don't want to hear a thing you have to say. Even when the Lord gives you one of those rhema words, right? That fresh word. They don't want to hear what you have to say. They shall put you out of the synagogues. Yea, the time cometh that whosoever killeth you will think that they doeth God a service. In other words, those who speak against what you're doing for the Lord, your authentic work for the Lord, those who speak against your, you know, they make up things about you, say things about you. Jesus is telling us they're going to do these things. Again, I'm going to tell you something. If they put you out of the synagogues and they have the power to put you out of the synagogues, then those that are running the organization don't want you to be in there. Just telling you that now. It's just the way it is. They don't want to hear a thing you have to say. Likely because when the Lord gives a word, it runs away that number one notion of gathering funds to yourself, doesn't it? So when you come in there with what the Lord gives you that has nothing to do with raising money, nothing to do with filling people's pockets, nothing to do with a promise on their lives, nothing to do with any of those things, but very sober topics that the Holy Spirit will give. Remember, the Holy Spirit gives a relevant word for the time you live in spiritually. It does. And it always gives you the truth. That is never, for no reasons, never wasted. The word is absolutely perfect. So it's not going to say the same thing over and over again as far as men's agendas go. But it's going to be very consistent in being rooted in the gospel of Jesus Christ, absent these desires of men. It will be. So they're going to put you out of the synagogues. In other words, they don't want to hear what you have to say, right? They don't want to hear your topics. When you're talking about love, they want their side to win. They don't want to hear you talk about love and unity. They don't want to hear you talk about cohesion, right? They don't want to hear you talk about anything like that. They want you to take a side and then say God is on that one side, not on the other, right? But they want you to say, but you don't talk like that, do you? What do you say? God is above all of man's mess. They don't want to hear that. How many of you know they don't want to hear a topic of love? Not God's love. They want their own type of love in there. Not God's love. God's love comes with a lot of discipline. They don't want to hear it. You're being told here, they're not going to want to hear anything that comes from you. That's what you're hearing. And whoever does an injustice toward you, whoever throws you under the bus, whoever is attacking you, tearing down what you're doing for the Lord, they're going to think they're doing God a service. Sound familiar, doesn't it? These things will they do unto you because they have not known the Father nor me. It is a known fact that if a person does not have a solid relationship with Christ, they don't exist to assist you. They want you out of the way so they can put forth what they believe God has given them. But it's going to be of the wrong God. When Christ came to this earth, he spoke against the doings of man. He spoke in love to us all regarding a cleaning up of our lives, a rededication of our lives unto what the Father deems as good and truthful by way of the Spirit, not for any of man's agendas. So when you start speaking of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the true gospel, the gospel that does not pick this side or that side, the gospel that does not support man's doings, they don't want to hear that because what you're going to do is mess up something for somebody else. They don't want to hear that. Men have taken the gospel right down through tradition, and they have their format of how they do things. They don't want any other word in the way because it may upset the Cunninghams over here to the left, or the Brigham Afros to the right, or the lullabies in the front and center. They don't want to offend anybody with a lingo of the gospel that would dare tell somebody that what they're doing in their homes is unlawful to God, that them not saying anything to their teenagers about sleeping around with everybody, that the Lord is not pleased with that. They don't want you to come in with your stuff. They want you to let things how they are so things can keep functioning, so that those in power may stay in power. They don't want you interrupting anything. If the Lord says this, The Lord is also telling us the desires of Satan regarding your life. If he says they're going to throw you out of the synagogues, it is a desire of Satan that you not be in there in the first place. Satan doesn't want you messing up their type of belief. It says that whosoever killeth you will think that they do with God a service. That's what they do today. One ministry throwing another ministry under the bus, thinking they're doing what they're doing for the Lord. Now to them, they're genuine, but you should know better, which is why you don't attack them back, because that will do no good. The Lord is forewarning us that none of us be moved by these things. He says, and these things will they do unto you, because they have not known the Father, nor me. So what he's saying is, if a person does not know Jesus Christ, that's when they'll throw you under the bus. If a person does not know Jesus Christ, that's when they'll have a set agenda that you have to meet before you can come into their synagogues. That's John 16, 1 through 3. Some of you have places locally just like that. If you don't match them, they're going to toss you out. If you don't speak the way they speak or speak the language they speak, they're going to toss you out. See, that's the difference between the gospel and that stuff. With the gospel, the Lord wants you to be 100% who you are. Those who follow the gospel understand that you're in the middle of a process. They are patient towards all. They're not pointing fingers. They're assisting. They're assisting. They stand ready to assist anybody who would ask them. Those who have a set agenda, they don't want anybody disturbing the waters. They're going to toss you out. They don't want to hear anything you have to say. That has to deal with the true gospel. They don't want you to come in and tell them. Learn to have patience with people who are less than what they are. They don't want to hear anybody come into these organizations saying, hey, the whole purpose of this thing is for the people you won't let in the doors. The one you just ran out because he didn't smell right, that's who it's for. The one you ran out over here because he smells like he's been drinking, that's who this is for. But you don't want them to mess up your seats. It's for the broken and the wounded. I had a dream that hurt me to my heart one time. I was walking and I saw this church, and it was these wounded people. I could see them all. I could see a couple of them at first. I saw a couple at first. And I saw these men, these two men, they were dressed in black. They were guarding the door at the church like deacons or something like that, ushers. Walked inside the church, and the ones inside looked just like the ones standing at the door. They all had, you know, similar clothing, suits on. But inside, everybody in the pews was dressed up in their nice little outfits. Outside, the wounded were out there. And when I looked back outside, I saw that the wounded, they tripled. It was so many wounded people out there. They would not let the wounded in because they didn't wear what they were wearing. In fact, the guy I walked up there with had broken his leg, and he was coming in the church. You would think that would be a sanctuary for the wounded. That's not what I saw. When I got him up there, he said, he didn't have clothing like this. He can't come in here. He doesn't look like we. He's asked to go change his clothes and everything. He's got to be in our condition to come in here. Look at him. He's got a broken leg. He's all messed up. He's got bandages. He can't have that stuff coming in here. He's got to look just like us. That hurt me to my heart because I saw the condition of what people flock to all over the world. A church where you have to look, you got to go out and buy $300 worth of clothing to go in there. You cannot go in there as you are. You cannot be broken and go in there. You have to look like everybody else does. Well, all the wounded were outside. The church refused to let in the wounded. That was a long time ago. I had that dream. Ever since that time, it is almost like I can see it in real time. How that those who seem to be holy and have holy organizations, they will not let in the wounded. If you have a problem, they're going to point a finger at you and say that you're all messed up. Well, of course you are. That's why you come into the church, to the ecclesia, the body, the gathering. When you're all messed up, that's the place, the sanctuary. It's not run like that these days. It's almost like you have to be healed of your wounds. You got to be spotless. You got to be perfect to come into their organization, or they're going to point a finger and start talking about you. That's what I'm talking about, folks. Because the wounded, the ones who are in bondage, the ones that can't escape sin, the ones that can't get it right, the broken ones, that's who the gospel is for. But they've turned it all the way backward, and they expect you to be a person of a specific standard before you can ever come in and fellowship. It's all backwards. A delusion is what? A delusion is a state of being. But if you're delusional, you think things that are not real are real. You think things that are not right are right. You think things that are not good are good. That means if you were delusional, you may be trying to eat a cactus. Because that cactus, if you're delusional, you may think it's just like a cucumber. And if you ever get a hold of that cactus and begin to eat it, well, you know what's going to happen. I don't think it's going to go down very well. But if God gives a person over to this, listen to me carefully, then they actually believe that the wrong they're doing is not wrong at all. If God gives them over to it, which he said he already would, then they actually believe in what they're doing. They actually believe in their murderous ways. Listen to me. The accuser of the brethren is but one entity. You have plenty of people in the world accusing their brethren, and they think nothing of it. They justify it with the word of God. They justify the killing of another with the word of God. They justify casting you out with the word of God. They justify hurting you with the word of God. And they think there's nothing wrong with it. That is delusional. When you think something that's actually killing somebody, when you think there's nothing wrong with it, you're delusional. And if God sends them into that state of being, no one's going to get them out. The Lord is telling everybody this before Him, before it ever happens, that there are going to be people in this condition, and Lord knows in this day and age, there are a lot of people who throw other ministries under the bus, and they have meetings about it, and they really think they're doing servitude unto the Father. When a person continues to do things against the living God, God will give them over to a reprobate mind to believe those things that they're doing are okay to do. That's a reprobate mind. Have you ever had a sin in your life that you knew it was wrong, but you did it anyway and you kept doing it until you got to the point that it did not convict you like it did at the beginning? Anybody ever do that? You ever have a sin that you were really convicted of the first time, but now there's almost no conviction for it? That's just like nudity on television. The first time a person sees somebody nude on television, well, back in the day, it was a shock. Now, it's almost like if somebody could be nude on television, everybody could look at the TV, and everybody was like, well, I didn't see any nudity. What are you kidding? They become numb to sin. It's almost like sin doesn't exist. It's still there. You know, the act is still there. But if you put up with it long enough, you become numb to it. Like cursing. Cursing does something to me. It does something to me. But for a lot of people, it's nothing. I can hear a person curse. I don't point fingers and do all that stuff. I hear it all the time. It always does something to me. I cringe through it. There's so many things that I cringe at. I cringe now. That's like when a person starts complaining, because I'm so thankful for what the Lord does. When a person starts complaining, that really stands out. It's like, my goodness, this person's breathing. They don't know what it is. This person's walking. This person is communicating. This person is not struggling to type or do anything else, yet they complain. What are you kidding me? Because the Lord has been so good to us. But a complainer does not recognize that goodness to a point to where they wouldn't complain. It still feels wrong to me. It feels disrespectful to me. It's almost like people have no fear of the Lord in them left. Hate is one of the biggest things. How can you hate another human being who's made in the image and likeness of the Creator? And sure enough, there's a scripture there that for a person who does hate what they see before their eyes, they reject God in doing so. But again, reprobate is when you no longer see sin. When you're conducting it, you're no longer convicted. You may be doing something that does not convict you anymore. That's what happens when you excuse sin. You become immune to it. This is why Jesus said we have to be purged. Because there was a time in the service, right, that I'm telling you now, if you put up with stuff, you'll end up, it'll start coming out of you. You're not immune to sinning. No, it's Christ that is in you is above the sin you would commit. And by His power, you're able to resist all sin. By His power, not by your own power. Because without Him, you don't have power to resist your own flesh. Without Him, you're eaten up by your own flesh. And it takes a conscious decision from anyone, from you all, to say, nope, no more, I'm not doing this. I will not do this. I mean, and that takes that's a fight. That's the beginning of a purging. It's a fight. So you're not immune to it. It is Christ in you that has the strength in you to overcome that sin. But don't think you're immune to it. Howbeit, when the Spirit of truth has come, He will guide you into all truth. For He shall not speak of Himself, but whosoever He shall hear, that shall He speak. But whatsoever He shall hear, that shall He speak. He's not going to speak of Himself. He's telling you. For He shall not speak of Himself. What does that mean? Jesus said the same thing. And then He said, what I speak, the Father has given me. So in other words, Jesus spoke what the Father gave Him to speak. And He's saying the Holy Spirit does not just make up stuff by itself, but whatsoever the Holy Spirit hears, that it speaks. And He will show you things to come. Now, why on earth would the Spirit of truth show you things to come? Puzzling, isn't it? It's very simple. Get this psychic stuff out of your head that was somehow thinking that's some sort of a special something. Listen, Jesus said, these things have I spoken unto you that you should not be offended. What things? He told people the future of how they would be treated so they wouldn't be so bothered when it happened. The Holy Spirit comes in the name of Jesus straight down to us. And if Jesus told us things to come to comfort us in His Word, that His Word would be complete in our lives, then the Holy Spirit gives what it gives for a purpose. But the Holy Spirit does not speak on its own behalf, but it speaks whatsoever it hears, because everything points back to one source for us. Not three or four different sources. One. Jesus said the Holy Spirit is given in His name. Jesus said the Comforter is sent in His name. He just said that the Holy Spirit does not speak of itself. See, a lot of people say, well, you know, the Holy Spirit, like the Holy Spirit is making up things or it knows something's given to people. No, the Holy Spirit speaks what is given to the Holy Spirit to speak. It is the ability that many people are missing. It is the fulfillment that many people have no idea. It provides great comfort if you know things about the Comforter. If you just have this topical argument, like most people are, they're still arguing over, is it three? Is it one? We know that everything is one in the Father, that nothing exists outside the Father, that all things come from the Father. We know that anything that came out of Him is still one with Him, because Jesus said, I and my Father are one. He didn't say two or three, He said one. We know that the Spirit of truth was housed within the Word of God when it was here. Thus, Jesus had to go sit at the right hand of the Father, that the Holy Spirit would be, another Comforter would be sent unto mankind in the name of Jesus. But we also know now that the Comforter does not speak of itself, but it speaks whatsoever it is given. But whatsoever He shall hear, that shall He speak that was spoken of the Holy Spirit. And He will show you things to come. He shall glorify me, says Jesus, John 16:14. For He shall receive of mine and shall show it unto you. He didn't say it might show it unto you. He didn't say it's a possibility He could show it unto you. No, He said He shall glorify me, for He shall receive mine and shall show it unto you. All things that the Father hath are mine, Jesus says. Therefore said I that He shall take of mine, Jesus said, and shall show it unto you. Let me read that to you one more time, just in case you are confused. John 16:15, all things that the Father hath are mine. That's what Jesus said. Everything the Father has is mine, Jesus says. Why? Because the Father hath given it unto His Son, and you're joint heirs with Christ. Therefore saith I that He shall take of mine and shall show it unto you. Those things of mine, Jesus just said, the Father, all those things of the Father, they belong to me, because the Father hath given them to me. And the Holy Spirit shall show those things that belong to me unto you. That's lacking nothing. That means you're not missing anything. The problem is, what if a person was rejecting the Holy Spirit and they didn't even know it? What if you really didn't know you were rejecting the Holy Spirit? Now, some people say, well, that's not our fault. We should still have it. Let me tell you this. It takes acceptance of Christ to be washed by the blood. It takes obedience in Christ to receive the Holy Spirit. There are steps. There is an acknowledgement, and that acknowledgement comes with maturity. And that maturity is granted to most when they have made a decision. A child can make a decision. But it's the Father that gives the increase in all things. He causes things to grow. The Father does. Nothing else does. Many can come across and water a seed. So they can sow a seed. They can water a seed. They can water it some more. They can nurture it and everything else. But the Father gives the increase. The Father determines the time when it grows. He determines the growth of that process. He determines your maturity. You don't determine your own maturity. You cannot earn maturity. It is something that the Father does. The Father will cause you to grow. Men may sow into your lives by way of preaching, by way of teaching, by way of many different avenues. Someone may come across and confirm the word that was given to you over and over again, but it is your Father in heaven who gives the increase. All those things that are of the Father's, they now belong to the Son, Jesus of Nazareth. It is Jesus who is the key to your life. The Holy Spirit is given through Jesus. Do you understand this? See, this was not in the Old Testament, because Jesus had not fulfilled what He had to fulfill. But when He fulfilled what He had to fulfill, He shut the door on many of the questions people would have. You look around in the world, and some of you can't believe what you're seeing on television. You have no idea how bad it could potentially get. But there is a notable change. You're seeing people that you know should have recognized the truth by now. You're looking at these political situations and you're saying, how many more times do we have to go through the same nonsense? It is the same thing. And people touting the same message with the same broken promise. This guy can fix it all and this guy can't. The same stuff coming out every 4 to 8 years. The same stuff over and over again. And we're in the same position today, if not worse, than we were 40 years ago. We're still dealing with racism. We can't even get over the color of our skins. Yet we know a lot about genetics. But people are still skittish towards one another. We're still paying for water. Yet we're supposed to be so advanced in technology. When are we going to begin to put all of our trust in the Lord? Be thankful for the understanding He's given to mankind to a degree. But to have our thanks placed solely upon the Lord. To redirect our reliance upon the Lord. To understand that through men he'll give into your bosom. So he works through man, but our thanks certainly goes towards him. To not join in with the voices that are in this world that keep going back and forward, resolving nothing, but having the same problem. When will we see? When will we grow? The Lord loves us, so he knows he has to wake us up. And there's no better way to wake up a believer than to have him see what he's been trusting in truth. We serve a God of truth. He will show us all things in truth. If we have trusted in something more than him, and we have throughout our lives, he's going to show us the truth of it. Our internal complaints that we have about things that we think are legitimate, he's going to show us the truth. He's going to show us who we really are. He's going to purge us first. John 16 is important because he just gave us three elements: sin, righteousness, and judgment. We just saw that John 16:11, the prince of the world is judged. Oh my, that's a big one. What do you mean the prince of the world is judged? Same thing he said when he said the prince of the world had nothing in me. The prince of the world has been cast out. Cast out of where? He no longer accuses you before God day and night, and them that dwell in the heavens. But the accuser of the brethren has been judged. If he's been judged, he's been cast out of that old serpent called the devil and Satan down to us, down to the earth. He's here. But he still can't do anything directly because he's been judged. He's been bound up. So he replicates himself in the earth, makes a copy of himself in the earth, and it looks just like him. Is called the beast. And then one of those spirits out of the earth will come up and overtake a human being, and that person will be called the Antichrist or false prophet. And the nations that will support this man will be the first beast. This one, an image of the beast, will be made by all the peoples of the earth. They'll see the power of the first beast, that coalition. They'll say, who'll be able to go against this coalition? But that coalition will be a Draco system just like Satan himself. It'll be a replication of Satan, the dragon. The dragon is a system with Satan being the head of that system. He'll replicate the whole thing in the earth. Satan is the head of a system. That's the dragon. Satan himself, Beelzebub, will be just like the Antichrist, will be in charge of it because the Antichrist will tell everybody to make an image to the first beast, and he'll give it power to see who would truly worship it or not. He'll work the miracles in the earth, calling fire down from heaven inside of all men. He's also the one that's called the false prophet. He'll be the restoration of something that existed a long time ago. See, when kings sat and ruled their kingdoms, they not only ruled men, but they ruled the faith of men. That's why you look at King Nebuchadnezzar, and he told people what to worship, but he was also their king. See, we split the two today, but they're about to be recombined. The kings, the presidents of today, they don't tell us what to worship, but they will. That day is coming quickly. A lot of people suspect it will be Islam. That will be the Antichrist figure. I have another notion for that, though. See, because in the Bible it's very clear. He worships a God his fathers knew not. A strange God will he increase with gold and silver. Islam was known not too long after Christianity. In fact, the wars of that. In fact, it was spoken about in the Bible, too. You know, I did some deep research on that. There's a religion today, though, that did not exist back then. It's growing by leaps and bounds. And in fact, most people follow it today and they don't even realize they're doing it. And it has the heaviest connotation of demonic power that I've ever witnessed. And its way is being established all throughout the earth. And no one is withstanding its spread. Because if one does not believe in Christ, they don't believe in the Word of God. You can't go around to somebody else to get to God. You have to go through His Word, which is Christ. Those who don't believe upon the Son, they can't get to God. In the Bible, it says, any who comes up a different way is a thief. You have to go through Christ, because that is the Word of God. That is the atonement for all of our sins. There is no other way. So then by that atonement, even to the impardonable things, by that atonement, we too are resurrected. And Jesus said, I and the Father are one. There was a discussion. He said he was going to show him the Father. No, one of the disciples said, show us the Father. He said, what do you mean, show us the Father? If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. He was describing something to us. Jesus was the one who said, God is spirit. No man hath seen God at any time, Jesus said. Therefore, we must worship him in spirit and in truth. Well, in order to worship him in spirit, you have to be in the spirit first. And the only way to be in his spirit is walk by the word, which is Christ. So all things are through Christ. And God sees us through his Son. The miracle of Christ is God will see us through him. He is our advocate. So he sees us through him, which is pure. Or else we are condemned. To see us through the blood is to see us without the sin. Because if we had sin on us, how then can we communicate with the living God? We cannot. But now we have power to go boldly to the throne of grace and find help in a time of need through Christ. So when people argued about the Trinity, they were arguing about the argument, about being right, about a doctrine, when that's not even the point. The point is, we haven't seen the Father, the Son, or the Holy Spirit. The point is, we believe what we're given by Christ, not man's doctrines, and we are taught by Christ. Now we're taught by Christ through the Holy Spirit, which is the Father's Spirit given to us through Christ. Now we know the truth, and if we continue in His Word, we'll live that truth. That's what happens when we continue. Jesus said, if you continue in my word, you are my disciples indeed, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. If you continue in the word, you're going to start living out the scriptures. Living out the scriptures, you're going to build experience in his deliverance, salvation, a slew of other things. And by knowing that truth, not reading that truth, but knowing that truth because you have experience with it, you'll be free of any bondage that would be on the face of the earth. God's word is by all means perfect, but we argue over the silliest things. Things we're not the authoritative person over. We're not the authoritative spirit over. We're just children. We argue over things that are so far beyond us, when in truth all we should say is when we have understanding of certain things, not argue about it, but say thank you, Lord. And then be patient and live through it, not trying to be right over the other person, but attempting to have our lives in accordance with the word of the Lord, that we may be acceptable unto God through Christ. That's a daily effort, but it's also an effort that we must choose. Once you choose it, it is the strength of Christ that will bring you all the way through. We don't bring ourselves through. A lot of people think I'm reasonably tough, especially mentally tough. What they don't understand is that in truth, I'm ready to fall apart at any given minute. But I believe in Christ and His resolve. My entire dependency is upon the resolve of Christ, His word. Without that word, there's no assurance in my life. Arguments are just another device, another tool of the carnal mind against that spiritual man within you. One of the keys is to continue in the Word of God, to begin to live the Word of God that we know He'll deliver us. Have you ever had a moment of doubt? Things were so bad you began to doubt? You ever have things so bad you begin to act on your own? You ever had things that bad? You're like, of all kind, know the Word of God, but I can't wait. It looks like everything is about to blow up in front of my face and I have no confidence. You become frightened, you become scared, you become everything you are not supposed to be, you become. And we try to defeat that by quoting scripture. I'm going to be the first one to tell you. You can quote that you're not scared all day. That doesn't mean you're not going to be scared. Here's the difference, though. When you're learning the Word of God and you wait upon the Lord, He's going to walk you through some things. You're going to have trials. You're going to have tribulations. In those trials and tribulations, if you continue in His Word, you're going to see the resolve of Christ. He's going to deliver you. You won't know how. You're going to end up at the ending point delivered and say, how did that happen? I've done that a few times. I look back on my life and say, wait a minute. You know, how in the world did I get to this point? Lord, thank you, but how in the world? And when I finally stopped kicking and screaming against the process, that when a trouble came, I said, okay, Lord, I'm going to perceive this as you correcting me, speaking to me, teaching me. And that's how I took it. I began to see something I never saw before. I began to see the method of the Lord working in real time. And when I saw that, I was so happy. I was troubled in the flesh, happy in the spirit. And when you know it, when deliverance came, I already knew it was coming. That's when I became a student in my trials. When the body can feel miserable, but your soul is just bouncing up and down. Hard to explain that you would understand it. But then you know the Lord will deliver you. And that changes the way you talk to everybody else. If a person comes to me and they're doubting the word and they have 1,000 points of proof against deliverance or anything else, I am not moved, nor do I reconsider my own stance. Because my answer would be, the Lord will deliver you. Because I know He delivered me countless times. I have experience with this deliverance. He has never failed in doing so. Because I know that, my faith in that area is unbreakable. Because instead of crying and screaming and kicking through a process, I became a student in the process. I wanted to learn of His Word. If a person believes in Jesus, but they don't have all the details about the Word, that person's going to be okay. Here's what happens. Here's another scenario. If a person believes in Christ, He is the one that will raise them. He has never failed in raising anybody. If a person believes in Christ, Jesus said, all who come to me, the Father hath given to me. When I came to Christ, really came to Him, there were a whole slew of things I may not have gotten right in my own head. There were things I didn't consider. There were things I may have had upside down. It was not a measure according to salvation and the job of Christ in our particular lives. He saw me through all of the flesh I had. He took me through all levels of the flesh I had. He raised me. He put this word in me. I'm not responsible for where I am with the Lord right now. I'm not responsible for that. But there's one thing I could not do. I could not believe. You guys understand that? There wasn't a time I could just sit and say, well, I don't believe in Christ. I couldn't say that. I believed in Christ. I didn't know all the details. And some details I knew that nobody ever taught me, but He didn't just cast me away. No. In order for someone to believe in Christ, the Father must put that belief in them. If the Father put that belief in them, but they don't have all the details about the Word, Jesus will raise them, and at the end, they'll be perfectly raised. So what they don't know now, they'll eventually know. There are certain people who they love the Lord. They don't know how the dynamic works between Jesus, the Father, and the Holy Spirit. They don't know. They don't know about the angels or anything else, but they will before the process is finished.